Hi friends, welcome to Beautifully Bookish Bethany, where I have new videos every week about books and the geeky mom lifestyle. In today's video, I'm talking about my 10 favorite nonfiction books that I read in 2020. Yet another installment in my lists of favorite books that I read in 2020. This is the last video I'm gonna film today. I think I'm on video like 6, so that's very exciting. So if I look the same in all of them, I'm okay with that. So in 2020, I read a total of 370 books, which is more than I have ever read before, but I read a lot of books I loved, and so I'm doing individual videos talking about my favorites across different genres. And in today's video, I'm talking about my favorite nonfiction. One thing that you should know going in is that I have very specific taste in the kinds of nonfiction that I like to read. So a lot of what you're gonna see here is books that focus on issues of race and gender, because that is most of what I enjoy reading. There are a couple of exceptions to that of other things I've thrown in there, but there's lots of different kinds of nonfiction that people like to read. That is most of what I'm into. So with that said, let's go ahead and count down my top 10 nonfiction books that I read in 2020. Coming in at number 10 is Wandering in Strange Lands, A Daughter of the Great Migration Reclaims Her Roots by Morgan Jerkins. This is one that I had on audio from Libro.fm, and I really loved it. This is an interesting book because it's part memoir, part historical investigation, tracing different Black people groups along the path of the Great Migration, and also with the author tracing her own family history. I found this to be really moving, really interesting. I learned a lot from it, and it also really made me want to, as my kids get older, help them retrace some of their roots in these areas. My in-laws live in Louisiana, and yeah, there was just a lot that was very interesting and meaningful in this book, and I loved it quite a lot, which is why it is number 10 on my list of favorites. Number 9 on the list is White Fragility, Why It's So Hard for White People to Talk About Racism by Robin DiAngelo. As you can see, this is one that I tabbed quite a lot. I personally got a lot out of this. There's been a little bit of controversy around this book, and I think one thing that does need to be said is that if you're only gonna read one book about race and race relations, this is probably not the book to pick up. I think this is a great book that adds a lot to the conversation if you are also reading other things by Black authors and things dealing with the history of America and other stuff that adds to this conversation. So this isn't like the book that I would recommend to people, but I did get a lot out of it. I thought it was very thought-provoking and will really challenge your own ideas about privilege and, and she says this is a book written by a white person for white people, and so I think you do need to kind of recognize who the audience for this is. That's who she's talking to. But I found this to be really helpful and thought-provoking, and it's number 9 in my favorites for the year. Number 8 was a little bit of a departure from the trend you're gonna see through many of these books. This is a classic memoir, All Creatures Great and Small by James Herriot. This was so fun and charming and sweet. I really, really enjoyed it. I ended up listening to this as an audio review copy because they re-released the audiobooks before PBS releases a show based on these memoirs in 2021 and had the actor who plays the main character voice the audiobooks. I was able to listen to it that way. And I just really loved it. I remember my mom loving these books, and I just never read them. But this is basically the first book in a series of memoirs that he wrote about being a veterinarian in Yorkshire pre-World War II. All Creatures Great and Small follows basically from the time that he graduates from veterinary school up to right after he gets married as a young man. And it's just filled with quirky characters and funny stories and heartwarming stories, and I just really, really loved it, enough that I decided to request book 2 so that I can listen to that as well. These were published in the 1970s, but I think they hold up really well, and if you haven't read this and you need something that's a pick-me-up, definitely would recommend. Then coming in at number 7 is Sisters in Hate, American Women on the Front Lines of White Nationalism by Seward Darby. This is a very intense book and a little bit difficult to get through, but it is powerful and I think something that if you're able to read it is well worth reading. It is a book written by a journalist who spent years following these women who have ended up in the white nationalist movement. And it is wild. It is wild to read the stuff, but also I think it does a good job of showing what it is that people find appealing about some of these groups, what they do to recruit women, and the fact that even though usually people are talking about men as the front of white nationalism, what this helps us understand is that women actually do and always have had a significant role in some of these groups. So yeah, this one was for sure very, very intense, but I thought it was fantastic and definitely needed to make my list of best of the year. I told you what I like reading in nonfiction, and look, this is what you're gonna continue to see. Number six was Stamped, Racism, Anti-Racism, and You by Jason Reynolds and Ibram X. Kendi. This is the YA adaptation of Stamped from the Beginning by Ibram X. Kendi, and it is so good. It is a fantastic adaptation for teenagers, but also for people who find Stamped from the Beginning to be too intimidating. Stamped from the Beginning is like a masterpiece that was incredible. I read it last year. It was one of my favorite books that I read last year, but I think that this is a really good entry point for people who want to ease themselves into that. This makes it a little bit more accessible. It's a much quicker read. Also, Jason Reynolds reads the audiobook and he's phenomenal. So if you're looking for a good audiobook with a nonfiction pick, I would recommend this. Really loved it and I think it's a great adaptation. Moving into my five favorite nonfiction books of the year. Number five was All Boys Aren't Blue by George M. Johnson. It is a YA memoir of growing up Black and queer in America. And I just thought this was so good. So powerful and just like easy to read, but perfect, I think, for teenagers who, you know, are queer and maybe don't feel safe talking about it or aren't sure how to deal with the intersection of being Black and being queer in America and the specific challenges that that brings. So I really appreciate George M. Johnson writing this. I thought it was beautifully done and just a really, really wonderful memoir. Number four is A Promised Land by Barack Obama. This is definitely a tome. This is part one of his memoir, his presidential memoir. It's about 700 pages long, but it is very, very good. It has his signature intelligence and warmth. It has humorous moments in it. It's got some zingers in it. And it is very clear reading this that he was thinking about this as a primary source for historians and political historians moving forward because he spends a lot of time deep diving into behind the scenes of politics and different policies and events that took place through his presidency. This one briefly summarizes his early life and early political career and then really gets into his presidential race and his first term of president. It ends right after the takedown of Osama bin Laden, and I would expect that the second volume that we're eventually going to be getting in this is going to follow the lead up to the presidential race for his second term and his second presidential term. So I thought this was so good. It's another one that I did the combo of where I read it physically while also listening to the audiobook, and he reads the audiobook himself and like he's fantastic. It was great. So highly recommend. I think it is a phenomenal book, even though it may not be everybody's cup of tea because it does get heavily into the policy stuff, but I really liked it. Number three this year is another memoir. This is Born a Crime by Trevor Noah. It is his story of growing up as a mixed race individual in apartheid South Africa. And this was so good. It was funny, but also heartbreaking. And this is the book that made me cry the most in 2020. Like, I was sobbing at the end of this book. Sobbing. Ugh, his mother is just incredible. This is another one, highly recommend if you're able to get the audio. It is an Audible exclusive, but the audiobook is really good, and I think you get his signature kind of wit and charm as he reads it himself. I really, really loved this and definitely recommend. Third favorite nonfiction book of 2020. All right, we are down to my top two best nonfiction picks that I read in 2020, and I think both of these are 2020 releases, are they? I don't know, let me see. They are, they're both 2020 releases. First up we have Hood Feminism, Notes from the Women That a Movement Forgot by Mickey Kendall. This was phenomenal. Like, I wish everybody would read this book. As you can see, I thoroughly tabbed this up. There was just, it was so rich in thought-provoking things. And this is a book by a woman who is a Black feminist talking about the problems with white feminism that often leave out or overlook things that affect women of color. A really, really powerful book and one that I would love to see everybody pick up and read. And finally, my favorite nonfiction book that I read in 2020, I was also one of the earlier books I read this in January, and it's another memoir. This is In the Dream House by Carmen Maria Machado. Wow, this one just absolutely blew me away. I listened to it on audio and was like, I have to own my own copy. And at some point it's one that I would really like to revisit and annotate because it's an intense one, but it's really powerful. It is her memoir of being in an abusive relationship with a former girlfriend. And it's intense. It's a really intense book. It's told in a really imaginative way that I think adds to the power of the book and the imagery that's being used in talking about these difficult issues. But one thing that I think is really important about this is it's getting at the existence of abuse in queer relationships and the way that that's often not talked about or overlooked, and especially abuse between women, and not just physical abuse, but emotional and psychological and financial abuse. So this is definitely an intense one, but it has a hopeful ending, and I loved it. I mean, it's not a fun read, but it is an emotional and powerful read and one that has really stuck with me all year long. So this was definitely my favorite nonfiction book that I read in 2020. So there you go. Those are my 10 favorite nonfiction books that I read this year. I mean, you can clearly see that there are themes, there are specific things that I really like to read and care about reading, and I'm very specific in the types of nonfiction I pick up, and your picks may be totally different. But hopefully this gives you a few new things to check out. Talk to me in the comments down below, let me know any of your thoughts or feelings on anything that I talked about in this video, and for your question of the day, tell me what was your favorite nonfiction book that you read in 2020 and what you loved about it. Talk to me in the comments down below. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you want to see more. And if you want to support the work of the channel, check out the Patreon linked down below. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.